All right, so by now, we should all be pretty comfortable with the whole generative fill, generative AI topic, right? Like, it's probably going to be the topic of the year for 2023. And I've done a bunch of videos myself on this channel where I'm showing photographers how you can use this technology to improve your photos. I'm very excited, though, because up until now, pretty much everything I've showed you has been using Photoshop on the desktop. Either we'd be using Photoshop beta or when it was moved into production, I showed it to you there, but it was on the desktop. I'm super excited, though, because in this video, with the latest update to Photoshop on the iPad, so this is specifically Photoshop for the iPad, we now have generative AI technology built right into the app. It's super cool, and I'm going to show you three different ways that you can use it as a photographer, plus one way that is more for creative. So let's check it out. All right, so on my iPad here, this is actually not Photoshop, this is Lightroom. And the reason why I am in Lightroom is because I think most of my audience uses Lightroom on the iPad. And so I wanna show you how you can do this from Lightroom. If you didn't wanna use Lightroom, the simple thing you would do is export your photo to your camera roll. You just go here and you would hit save copy to device. And then you can go into Photoshop to open it there. But because Lightroom and Photoshop are connected on the iPad, we might as well take advantage of that. So this photo was already edited. I took it with my iPhone 15 Pro Max and I used an app called Re-Expose to get this long exposure. And if you tap and hold, you can see there is the original. This is the edit, very little done to it. But in this example, what I want to do is show you if I wanted to convert this to a square. This is a vertical photo. So I wanna convert this into a square, but I don't wanna cut into my composition. So with generative expand, we can do that. So let's go ahead. I'm gonna tap on this share icon here and you can see there is edit in Photoshop. So I'm gonna tap on that. And here you can see the photo is now in Photoshop. This is Photoshop for the iPad. Now, two quick things that I should have said before, but these go without saying. The first is you need to be subscribed to Adobe's photography plan or the all apps plan. So the photography plan will give you access to Lightroom as well as Photoshop. If you are subscribed to the Lightroom only plan, you can't do this because it doesn't come with Photoshop. The other thing is, obviously, if you do have Photoshop installed on your iPad, the first thing you should do is go to the App Store and make sure that you have the latest version because that version is the one that has the generative fill technologies. All right, let's get back to it. All right, so what I want to do is convert this to a square. Let me just pinch out here so you can see the whole image, but I don't want to crop in. I want to maintain the height of this photo and I want to basically expand it left and right. So to do that, the first thing we need to do is actually expand the canvas. And the way that I'm going to do that is I'm going to tap on the crop icon over here on the left toolbar. And you can see now we have our crop mode. The first thing I want you to pay attention to is at the top center, you'll see the resolution of the image. So it's 3024 by 4032. That's important because that's how I'm going to guide myself in terms of making this square. So all I'm gonna do is tap on the left bumper here and drag out until I get to 4032. Now you can see that I stopped at 4029 by 4032. And that's because when you use this, you'll see it can be a bit frustrating if you're using your finger or even the Apple Pencil. To get a fine result, you can tap to enter in a value in this mode here, and that's fine. This is gonna serve us just fine for demonstration purposes. So here, let's pretend it's a perfect square. And so what I'm gonna do now is tap done. Okay, so now we have our square canvas, but the image is biased to the right. And what I want to do is move it centered so that we fill the left and right evenly. Now, if I were to just tap and drag, you can move it, but you see how it kind of goes up and down? And that can be kind of annoying to get it perfectly centered. So I'm gonna undo that. And you see that little shaded circle to the left of the canvas? If I tap and hold that, it's kind of like a multi-mode button. So you see on the top right when I'm tapping and holding, it says move constrained. So now if I move left and right, it only goes left and right. And so I can position that in the center and I don't have to worry about it moving up or down. Now here's where generative expand differs from the desktop. So if you watch my other videos, and I'll put a card here for the video where I show how to use generative expand on the desktop, you can just use the crop tool to expand just like we did. And then as part of that, you can do generative fill to those extra areas. On the iPad, it requires just one extra step, and I'll show that to you right now. So the extra step is we need to make selections of the areas that we want to fill. So you can see that we have this kind of empty area to the left and right of the image. And so what I'm gonna do is tap on the marquee tool here. If you don't see that, you might see the lasso over here. Just tap and hold to expand and then select this marquee rectangle tool. Now, what I'll do is make a selection with part of the image in the selection. So you see here how we have a little bit of the original area in the selection, but and then the rest of it is also selected. Now I'm gonna go ahead and select the right. And when I do, did you notice what happened? The left selection is gone. And that's because we're in this kind of single select mode. So how can you make additive selections where every time you go to make a selection, it's added to the existing one? Well, on the bottom left, you see four icons. By default, you'll be on the single select, which is just that square. But the one we want is the one below it, which looks like two squares that are overlapped. So I'm gonna tap on that. And then I'm just gonna do the same thing as before. I'm gonna make my selection here, and then I'm gonna make my second selection over here. And you see now that both selections have been retained. Now here's where it gets awesome, because on the bottom toolbar, you'll see that there is a new generative fill icon. So I'm gonna tap on that, and I'm not gonna type anything in here. I'm just gonna tap on generate, and what Firefly will do is it will sample those selections and fill them intelligently. So let's go ahead and do that. All right, so if you've watched any of my other videos on this topic, you'll know that whenever you use generative fill in Photoshop, you're presented with three options. So this is actually pretty good, but I always recommend just going through the other options, and you'll see them on the right towards the bottom. You see three different thumbnails. So this is the first one. Let's see what the second one. Oh, that's excellent. Let's see if the third one beats it. Nope, it has that weird thing on the top left. So we're gonna go with the second one, and you can see now, we have effectively expanded our canvas to a square composition. And what's best is that we did not have to crop in. We didn't lose any resolution, which is really important. But I just want to kind of illustrate how seamless that is. I mean, if you were to look away and then look back, you would never be able to tell that we expanded this canvas using Generative Expand. And so I mentioned that there are three primary ways that a photographer would want to use this kind of technology. And the first one I just showed you is expand. So we want to take our canvas and change the aspect ratio, so to speak, which is what we just did. We went from kind of a 3:4 to a 1:1 aspect ratio. So the next thing, and this is super, super helpful, is removing. Whenever you have something in your image that you want to remove, there are various ways to do it, including using a remove brush, which is phenomenal. I have this video on that as well. But using generative fill can also be very effective, and I'll show you how to do that right here. I'm gonna stick with the same photo, and just to illustrate, what I'll do is I'm gonna go back to my layer here, and I'm gonna change my select mode to lasso. Now, let's say I wanna remove that center pillar that's in the foreground of the image. So I'm gonna make my selection here, and I'm just going to draw, and I'm also gonna include the shadow area that's casting. And so that's my selection here. If I want to remove something, all I do is I make a selection with whichever selection tool you want to use, and then I'll go back to generative fill. And just like before, I'm not gonna type anything. I'm gonna tap on generate. When you have a blank text box, Firefly will just assume that you want to either remove something or fill it in intelligently. So I'm gonna go ahead and tap on generate. And I mean, I am constantly amazed at this technology. If you are kind of on the fence, or just someone who, I don't know, maybe you're just afraid of this kind of technology, I don't know. You have no reason to be. It is so powerful, especially when you're probably doing these things already. Like, you're probably using the healing brush or the clone stamp tool or the new remove tool to get rid of things. Why not use this as well? And you can see just how good it is. It's so powerful. In fact, I mostly use this if I need to do a lot of object or obstruction removal. So again, though, let's just look at the other options here. That first one, I think, is just great. I mean, you would never know that there was a center pillar, and it even blended out the reflection or shadow that it was casting, which is really impressive. And so that was the second of the three use cases for photographers, right? First one was expand, second one was remove. The third one is add. And I have this at the end kind of because photographers can take it or leave it. This is where you want to add something to your image that you've already created. So I took this photo, And granted, I used Generative Fill to expand the aspect ratio to a square, and then I used Generative Fill also to remove that center column. What if I wanted to add something to the photo? So I can do that again over here. I'll tap on the layer over here, and again, with the lasso selected, I'm just going to make a selection right over here. I'll tap on Generative Fill, and I'm going to type. This is now the first time that I'm actually typing. This is where you'll type what you want. So I'm going to type in an airplane and then tap generate. Then, you know, that one's okay. Let's see what this one, that one's not bad. And that one, I wouldn't take that one. This second one's okay. One of the things you should also know though, is you can tap on generate again to get another three options. So let's go ahead and tap on it again. That one's not bad. I don't like that one. That's actually perfect. That looks great. So here we now have an airplane. Now, obviously, this doesn't make sense visually because it is a long exposure photo and I added a plane that is perfectly still. So I wanted to show you how you can add an object, but don't forget about that visual continuity. So here you can see it's a long exposure, but that plane is perfectly still. So anyone who kind of was scrutinizing it would be able to tell that something is not adding up. But as you can see, it is quite easy to add an object to your photo. Now I have one more use case for Generative Fill, and this is more of really a creative avenue for a photographer to explore. This has nothing to do with working with photos that you've already taken. Before I do though, I do want to tell you, if you are into this kind of workflow, working with Lightroom Mobile and Photoshop, and you just want to take advantage of that entire cloud-based ecosystem on your desktop, on your iPad, on your iPhone, on your mobile devices, please check out my course, Lightroom Everywhere. I've talked about it a lot because I'm so proud of it, and it will teach you everything you need to know about this ecosystem. There are over 9 hours of easy paced lessons. I've been so grateful for the positive response from students. They love it, and it really means a lot to me. Again, your purchase, it supports my small business. It helps me continue making these videos for you. So the link is in the description. Thank you so much for that. So with that, let's go back to the iPad. All right, so now that we're done here, let's just wrap up this particular workflow. You'll see a nice blue button on the top left that says Send to Lightroom. If you want to keep this, we'll tap on that. So if I tap on it, you'll see it's going to save it and then close it. And it's writing a PSD file. Now we're back in Photoshop. You can see the document was received. You see that message on the bottom. And you can see to the right of that DNG file, there is now a square image with the Photoshop badge on it. And if you don't see those badges, that's because you might not have overlays enabled. So to view them, with two fingers, you'll tap and you'll keep doing that until you have show file type selected. And here you'll see that is now a Photoshop document. So if I tap on it here, there is the image. It gets uploaded to the cloud. So it's being synced right now, as you can see over here. And then it will be available on all of my other devices. But let's say you just want to have some fun. You want to create something from nothing. I don't necessarily think that this is the most practical use of Generative Fill for photographers, but I also think that there is a creative outlet here. If you just have no opportunity to get out and shoot, but you want to create something from nothing, it's kind of fun, the fact that you can do this now on the iPad. So let me show you what I mean. So I'm not even going to start in Lightroom here. I'm going to swipe up and go to Photoshop. And I'm going to start with a new document here. And I'm going to go with this preset. It's just an HD resolution, 1920 by 1080. And I'm going to tap on Create. So here you can see there is our blank canvas. And if you remember, if you want to do anything with Generative Fill, you first have to make a selection in Photoshop. So what I'll do is I'll tap over here and then go back to the marquee rectangle, and then I'll make a selection of the entire canvas. Now that brings up the toolbar on the bottom. I'm gonna tap on Generative Fill, and I'm gonna type a prompt. So I'm gonna type in a field with rolling hills and green grass under a blue sky with puffy clouds, and then tap generate. And so you can see this is actually a pretty cool kind of painterly look. It gave me exactly what I asked for, but I have three completely different options. So I'll just stick with this one over here just to illustrate. Here is the first option. Now what I'm gonna do is that was creating something out of nothing. I'll go ahead and make a lasso selection here, and I'm just going to draw a selection like this. I'll go to Generative Fill, and I'm going to type in a red barn and tap Generate. And I mean, it just, to me, this is so amazing. It added a barn, but it added it at the correct perspective with the correct lighting. I have these other options here, but really that first one is just kind of cool. And I don't know, I like it. I think it's so awesome. Again, I can go ahead here and right here, just make a small selection, and I'll say a white horse running. Technically, I guess it's galloping, but don't tell anyone. And I mean, I guess in this case here, it gave me a few horses, which I actually kind of like. I like that they're darker. There's more of a contrast there. There's this one, which I don't know what that is. Here, that's also pretty good, but I think this one is great. And again, it all fits the perspective. But again, we basically divined this out of nothing. We started with a blank canvas, a completely blank canvas. And I just used a few different selections and prompts to build this photo. And it, in my mind, it helps me, if I were to look at this, it helps me figure out composition. I like the fact that I put, for example, the barn towards the right third of the frame. I also like that the way the entire background was created was with the ground, the landscape, taking up the lower third of the frame, and it gave me a nice big blue sky. So these are the kinds of things that I wouldn't say necessarily are too important for photographers. The first three that I showed you, expand, remove, and fill, those are definitely good for photographers. I think most photographers can find really clear applications and use cases for their own work. But the whole generative creating out of nothing, it depends. If it's just something you kind of want to have fun with, by all means, enjoy it. You've got it right there. So again, with that, if you are excited about this kind of workflow, working with Lightroom and Photoshop on your mobile devices, having everything sync across, check out my course, Lightroom Everywhere. Links in the description below. And I also have this playlist. This is the playlist that has all of my generative AI videos. So if you want to learn more, definitely check it out. If you enjoyed this video, thumbs up is always helpful. And be sure to hit the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot.